प्रेम से बोलिए शिष्य आनंद मयी मात की जय। समवन वॉज रीडिंग आउट अ पोएम ऑफ हिज ओन क्रिएशन। इट बिगिन विद अ कन्वर्सेशन बिटवीन शिवा एंड पार्वती। पार्वती वॉन्टेड टू नो वेदर ऑल पीपल हु डाई एट काशी वुड बी लिबरेटेड देन एंड देयर। नो वॉज शंकराज रिप्लाई, नॉट ऑल, ओनली भक्ताज who possess firm, unflinching faith. Now the question arose as to what was the criterion for firm, unflinching faith, for it is by no means always possible to judge of the depths of a person's faith by outward appearances. In order to test people's faith, Shiva and Parvati in disguise went to Manikarnika Ghat. Parvati sat down on the steps with her dead husband lying across her lap. In pitiful words, she begged every passer by to bring her some firewood for her husband's cremation. Many people, deeply moved by the sight of the poor widow and her dead husband, were only too eager to comply with her request. But, said Parvati, there is one condition. Before my husband passed away, he voiced the express wish that the firewood should be supplied only by men entirely free of sin. I am therefore in duty bound to ask this great kindness only from those of you who are not guilty of even a minor sin. On hearing this, not a single person was prepared to fetch the firewood, for none could deem himself completely free of sin. Just then, a man who had come to bathe in Ganges approached. He was not only a drunkard, but he indulged in other vices as well. As soon as he came to know of Parvati's request, he exclaimed, "What is there so difficult about it? Just wait a moment till I have had my bath in the Ganges." He dived into the sacred waters and speedily returned to the poor widow with firewood in his arms. "Are you quite sure that you are entirely free from sin?" questioned Parvati. "How dare you doubt it?" replied the drunkard. "Have you not with your own eyes seen me immersed in the purifying waters? As that very instant, all my sins were washed away. This is Shankara's own promise. Here, take the wood and go ahead with the cremation." Someone who had listened to the story did not feel convinced. "The story sounds good enough. Nevertheless, is it really possible for a man of such unshakable faith to live in sin?" Someone else explained, "From a man's outer behavior, one cannot guess what stage of spiritual development he may have reached. He may be highly advanced and yet have to work out a little bad karma that has been left over. Through the force of his prarabdha, he may have been obliged to misconduct himself for a time in the manner mentioned in the story. In this way, his unusually strong faith becomes understandable." Another person put in, "Both statements are the truth, Mataji. Truth is one. How can there be two truths?" The same person as before, "Whatever anyone perceives from his own standpoint is for him the truth, Mataji. Where there is no question of standpoints and opinions, where the food he who eats and the action of eating are one, their truth is one and nothing exists beside the one truth. But where something is, it is due to the veil of ignorance. At the very instant of enlightenment, this veil will be rent and all ignorance and sin, however grave or manifold, will be burned up. In such a state, wrong action cannot occur. Yet there is another thing to be said. A man may have accumulated a great deal of merit and yet have to work out a tiny little bit of karma. A lively discussion was going on. Mataji, it is said that the question calls for the answer. Someone, for instance, says, how can I find truth? How can I learn to meditate successfully? If one keeps on asking persistently, the answer must come. At this point, some gurgling sound could be heard from among the audience. These were being uttered by a European gentleman who fell back unconscious with his eyes turned upwards, his face becoming bluish and foam forming on his lips as it happens with epileptics. Everyone's attention was instantly diverted to him. Mataji said, this old gentleman has been practicing meditation for the last 30 years. His practice was based upon instructions received from books and not directly from a competent teacher. What is happening to him is the natural consequence of this. Whenever he sits down for meditation, he falls into a trance-like condition. It is not true meditation, for his mind, not being purified in a proper way, cannot contact eternal peace within the heart and attain to stability. Failing this, it strays away along different channels, and this leads to unhappy consequences which point clearly to the necessity of direct guidance by an efficient master. The prescriptions and directions of the guru are in strict consonance with the actual needs and capacities of the disciple, as a result of which he will be free from the troubles which follow from wrong direction. There is one more thing. He who has no deep yearning in his heart for realization of the divine, but merely practices breath control mechanically, may have to face unhappy results, such as you are witnessing here. प्रेम से बोलिए शिष्य आनंदमयी मात की जय।